They said I wouldn't make it. They said I wouldn't be here today. They said I never would amount to anything. But I'm glad to say that I'm on my way. And I'm growing more and more each day. There were many that started out with me, but now they've gone astray. But I'm still holding on. I'm still holding on. I'm still holding on to His hand. Is there anyone's testimony in the house this morning? Is there anyone that can lift their hands and say, I'm still holding on? See, when I was young, I gave God my hand, and I told Him to lead the way. Though the road has been rough, and the going is mighty tough, see, I ain't going nowhere. I'm right here to stay. I've been talked about, and no, I've been criticized. I had to wipe many tears from my eyes. But I'm still holding on. I'm still holding on. I'm still holding on to His hands. And all of God's people say amen. How y'all doing?
How you doing, Reverend?
It's indeed another privilege to be in the house of the Lord once more and again. But for those who can testify, it's nice to know that y'all are still holding on. Because there are so many that are falling by the wayside. The Bible said that the devil will come along and fool even his very elect. Because he knows how to dress it up so pretty. But then when you take the clothes off, you find out that it was a trick in disguise. Because God is still on the throne. No matter what's going on in our lives. I always remember, no matter what's going on in your life, it's a great time to praise the Lord.
Hello.
We're still in the month of May, and we're looking at Jesus this month, and we're going to go one chapter over from our responsive reading to Romans chapter 8. And no, Miss Brenda didn't call me and ask me what I was preaching. I just know we serve a God that knows.
Amen.
Romans chapter 8. We'll be looking at verse 31. Romans chapter 8, verses 31. Romans 8:31, and it reads, what shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of His word. Just a three-word topic this morning. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. For those that know that I am into sports and love the Saints, love the Spurs, love the Braves, but I didn't play anything professionally. Where I played at, we would have to go to a court, whether it was in a gym, it was a park, or someone had a basketball game behind their house. And for those games, we call them pickup games. That means you play with who's ever available. Now, sometimes some of us were better than others, so we may have heard our name called out first when it was time to pick. But no matter what's going on, no matter the talent level, there was no way for us to play unless every team was equally matched. Now, we could have a team of all three good people and a team of all three bad people, but the team didn't play until everybody was picked. Think about if we was out there playing and Michael Jordan walked up. Or if we was out there playing and Akeem the Dream Olajuwon walked up. There would be no question that as soon as it was time to pick teams, these guys would be the first ones to get picked. Due to the fact of what they can bring to the team. Jordan was tenacious and could goodbye anybody. Akeem the Dream had made more moves than a dance routine because he knew how to get free to score the ball. But what will you do when you try to pick your spiritual team? Will you pick up Moses since he parted the Red Sea? Will you pick up David because he was a man after God's own heart? Would you pick up Noah because he said it would rain for many years, but nothing happened until it started raining? Oh, there's some great biblical characters in the Bible, but if I had a spiritual pickup game, give me Jesus. Those boys can do everything, but they're nothing but a mere copy of who Jesus is. Because Jesus walked on water. Forget the court. He don't even need land. He can dunk and ain't got no balls. We got to have Jesus. And in this text, we find out that if Jesus is on our team, it don't matter if Akeem Olajuwon is on the other side. It doesn't matter if Michael Jordan is on the other side. Because the text says, what shall we say to this? If God be for us. I thought I see somebody waving their hand because if you've been walking with him long enough, you found out that he makes the difference. If you've been walking with him long enough, you know that he can turn any situation around. Jordan can't do that. Barack Obama, great man, can't do it. Give me Jesus. Jesus in the morning. Hey, Jesus in the midnight hour. Jesus when I can't call nobody else. Give me Jesus. Because Jesus comes and he ain't trying to be a ball hog. He ain't trying to run the offense. All he wants to do is come into your heart and change you from the inside out. Because God, all of us look good today. I see you in your mask and everything. You took a shower and got your hair done. But guess what? Pastor can't see what's on the inside. Pastor don't know what you're thinking right now. But Jesus do. And Jesus don't care less about your outside appearance. And he can change what's in your heart. And he can change what's in your mind. Be ye like Christ. I need Jesus. And in the world we're living in now, we need them every day of our life. When you turn on the news and hear about shootings at Walmart where people just going about their everyday life. Thinking they going to get them a hamburger helper and some juice and go on back home. And somebody come in with demented thoughts and shoot up everybody in the place. We need Jesus. I never understood how it was so easy to take a life when you can't give life. We are all on borrowed time. We on God's time. How can I take your life when I owe my life to somebody else? If God be for us, who can be against us? I'm talking to some timid Christian that's scared to call Jesus' name. Don't be scared. He just said, if I'm for you, it doesn't matter who's against you. If I'm for you, I'm a little brother. I got two older brothers. If I'm with them guys, ain't nothing you can say to me. Because I know if it get hot, all I got to do is back up. Because they going to step forward, because they going to protect. respond the righteous way when they around you need Jesus. Yes, sir, I need them in my life. The world is hard sometimes. It'll weigh you down, but Jesus said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Give me Jesus. That's right. It's three reasons. Why are we, I'm going to talk for Quentin today. Three reasons I want Jesus. And I hope you feel the same. It's three reasons I want Jesus. Three reasons why you give me Jesus. First of all, because this life, you're going to have foes. F-O-E-S. Foes. Enemies. Haters. Give me Jesus, because in this life, you're going to have foes. Let me bust somebody off. Everybody don't like you. I'll say it one more time. Everybody don't like you. I know they smile in your face. I know they say, hey girl, when you're at Walmart. But everybody that comes across your path don't have your best interest in mind. That's why he said that if I'm on your side, it don't matter about their intentions if you get my hand. We hear Romans 8, and a lot of people consider Romans 8 to be one of the greatest chapters in the Bible. Because if you go up a couple of verses, you find out that he said that, and we all know that all things work together for the good of them that love God and are be called according to his purpose. Now, I don't know about you, but that helps me with every problem I go through in life. Because even though it looks bad, even though it don't feel good, he said, if you keep on working with me, I turn everything to good for those who are be called according to his purpose. Let's stand right there. For those that are be called. Everybody's situation ain't turned out good because everybody ain't called. That's why you got to be careful who you surround yourself with, because in this life, you're going to have some foes. You're going to have some people that ain't happy about your promotion. You're going to have some people that ain't happy about their new car. But they were the one at the dealership when you signed the papers, Jesus was. They went in the interview when you got the job, Jesus was, because he said, I'm for you. I'm more than the world against you, baby. Talk about me if you please. I'm with Jesus. You know how it was when y'all used to go out. And y'all on the way to wherever y'all going out. And you hear this. We came together. We leave together. If one of us fight, we all fight. And the one that don't fight, when you get back, the rest of us fight you. Because that was the motto of us since we were together. But Jesus' motto is better. If you stand with me, I'll fight for you. Because the word said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Ain't no need of me not getting no sleep when Jesus say, I got your back. Ain't no need for me having ulcers all in my stomach because Jesus say, I got my back. I ain't surprised, because in this life you gonna have some foes. So ain't no need of you crying and calling your mama and talking, oh, look, they ain't talking about me. Baby, get some. I'm gonna say some. Get your backbone.
Come on now.
Get your backbone, because everybody ain't your friend. And if they lied on Jesus, what you think they gonna do to you? We gotta get to the point to where we're not so spaghetti backed. If you don't know what that means you're weak. Yeah, you can't stand on nothing. Anything that blow you over, come on, baby. You can't be still or paid in the word. If you keep on reading the New Testament, he said, I desire to give you meat, but you were still choking on milk. And that's a lot of Christians in 2021. They can't give you no meat because you're still choking on milk. The only Bible verse you know is Jesus' well. Baby, that's milk. But when you get to the point where you quote Matthew 6:33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these things shall be added. You need some meat then. When you can say, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. You need some meat then. When you say the cattle on the thousand hills is yours, you need some meat then, because in this life, you're going to have some foes. That's why you got to give me Jesus. Because he's bigger than my feelings. He's bigger than my emotions. And he's better than who I am. Think if a human was sitting on high instead of Jesus. Don't worry, I'll wait. I go even further. What if it was you on high? Overseeing the rulers of the world. World have been gone 2,021 years ago. Because we live off our emotions. Christ lives because he is God. Besides, he there is none other. He forgives who we wouldn't forgive. Because guess what? Some people wouldn't forgive you. And some people wishing for your downfall as we speak. But they can do what they want to if you're in God's hands. That's what we got to get to. No matter what you say about Quentin, it's going to sting. Whoever came up with that quote, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, the words that never hurt," is a liar. Because the right words from the right person will break your heart. The right words from the right person have you somewhere looking at a tree and some rope. So words can't hurt, but if you got God, he can turn those words into success. And like when they say it to hurt you, that's why he came up with Psalms 23. I prepare a table before you. In the presence, not your friends in the presence, not your family in the presence of your folks. Give me
Jesus.
First reason, because in this life, you will have folks. Second reason, you got to give me Jesus, because in this life, you'll have failures. You have foes. You have failures. If I had a show of hands, mostly 95% of people in here are not doing what they thought they was doing in high school. You had big old dreams. Oh, I'm going to go down to Southern and I'm going to get my degree and I'm going to open up my own business. And most of us, some of us still paying rent. Ain't seen the building, the business, nothing. Life is full of failures. But like we just read in Romans 8:28, who is it a failure to? Who is it a failure to? Because some of our lives, some things are failure because it don't add up to somebody else's dreams. We feel like we are failure because we don't line up with the Jeffersons or the Joneses. But baby, do you got a roof over your head? Do you got a car to drive? Do you got a job to go to? Do you got somebody that loves you? Do you have children, grandchildren, baby? Show me where the failure is. Sometimes we said our goals too high. The old song said, this world is not my home. We're just pilgrims. Passing through, the reward is on high. So if you don't get the house down here, that don't mean you a failure. Maybe you just setting up your temple. An old song said, I'm sitting up my timbers every day. I'm working on a building. It's a true foundation. I'm holding up the bloodstained banner for my Lord. As soon as I get through, I'm going up to heaven to get by. So maybe they ain't a failure. Maybe you're looking at it through the wrong glasses. It's not looking at it through the glasses of the world. It's all looking at it through the glasses through the master. Talking about a failure. Jesus said foxes have holes. Birds have nests, but the Son of God don't even got nowhere to lay his hand, baby. You ain't no failure. Open your eyes. Because with Jesus, all things are possible. Because what you are crying about, somebody to get ain't left arm to have. What you fussing about, somebody else ain't got that or what you have. Please give me Jesus. Because when you got Jesus, that hoop, it look like a Lincoln. Because it's paid for. It don't warn me. It got good gas mileage. And you looking over the fence at somebody, they got a $100,000 car, $5,000 house note, and you sit up there, what for you? And they robbed and beat the paintball, and they When you look through it through Jesus' eyes, you know that every good and perfect gift comes from God. And the older you get, the more you realize all that stuff you don't need anyway. We got people downsizing now because they went and built a 6-bedroom, 5-bedroom house and can't go upstairs no more. Now it's someone trying to sell it in the market, man, and they ain't gonna get back what they put in it, baby. But watch yourself of what you consider a failure. Because if I be for you, I'm more than the world against you. I'm about to help. Give me Jesus because you got focus. Give me Jesus because life has failures. And give me Jesus because he's our connection to the Father. Three reasons why I want Jesus. It's because in this life he will have foes. In this life he will have failures. And then he's our connection to the Father. I love Romans 8 because you read a couple of verses up, he said we are heirs with God and co-heirs with Christ. If you remember the prodigal son, when he left, the father had to divide up everything between his sons. But he wasn't dead. He left, spent all this stuff, and came back, and he told the other son, everything I have is yours. And that's how God is to Jesus. Everything that's in God's hand is in Jesus' hand. And since I have died in flesh and rose again spiritually with Christ, now everything in Jesus' hand is in my hand. Because we are brothers that serve. I mean, we are brothers under God. Once he died, rose, and went to the grave, rose early Thursday morning, we became co-heirs with Christ. And I don't know about you. I've seen some families break up because of air rooms. I've seen families tear apart over $3. They had $3 and 11 kids and they try to split it. Girl, don't put $3 going about your dad. But with God, we inherit everything that Jesus inherited. If you are part of the plan. That's one thing we have to start looking at when we out here trying to save. Some of these folks ain't part of the plan. Either because they don't know or they don't care. But I'm part of the plan. I know when I die and he take me on out of here, I got my mansion, my robe, my streets paved with gold, whatever cliche you want to use, I'm happy. Because I'm a co-heir with Christ. And the only thing, reason why I'm a co-heir is because he came and died and saved us back to ourselves. And in my introduction, Jordan died for me. Akeem, a great basketball player, he didn't die for me. Moses didn't die for me. Jacob didn't die for me. David didn't die for me. Noah didn't die for me. Jesus died for me. So give me Jesus. Yes, sir. Bible says for a good man, some are pre-eventually die. But Christ commended, God commended his love toward us. That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. And you might not like that word, but let me look at you. You are part of the ungodly. You're not the hero in the text. You're the villain. The world had you thinking that you are the hero in the text. No, baby. You're the villain. You are the person that he had to come to and die for so we can go there. Come to die for so we can go there. Because the end mission for any Christian is to get to heaven. And the only way we can get there, you got to give me Jesus, the doors of the church. And you don't have Jesus in your life. He's still available. I must work the works of him that sent me by his